Shall we start on time for once? Okay, guys, so thanks for being still here after 4 days of workshop. So yesterday we had nice talks and data with human subjects, and this morning theme will switch and shift towards animals, with the difficulties you have working with animals, because you cannot explain to a monkey that you would like him or her to do this or that. It takes time to convince the animal to do what you want it to do. And we've, at least for Sergio's talk, some different kinds of data where you put electrodes inside the brain and you get to see some spikes. So I will be brief because I won't show you any data. I just wanted to continue to one of the theme we talked about in this workshop, reproducible analysis and open data. For the data and analysis that will be partly presented this morning, my current view is that we don't have a method that satisfies everyone at that stage. I mean, depending on the type of data people work with, they will proceed in different ways. And I think the best way to progress at that stage is to be explicit on what we do precisely on the data and to report that. So that's the way I'm currently doing it. I'm in favor of simple tools, and I do the analysis by accumulating simple steps rather than using an integrated approach, but that's my personal taste. And if you want to get an idea of that, look at my page of the Lascon course last January. There's an example of spike sorting, which more or less describes the way I'm now currently proceeding when I do this analysis. And so we are in the process of doing a systematic analysis of my locus data with Ludmila and Pierre. And so the idea is that you will get access to, you already the raw data are available, and all the analysis going from the raw data to the spike trains and later on fitting the Gravesa-Schobert model will be accessible in the same way. And that's more or less all I wanted to say. And I will give to Daniel the right to speech about thermodynamics, a thermodynamic approach to marmoset vocal development.
Hi, everyone can hear?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Sorry, so I have to apologize first because I'm noticing that there are actually a big lag between the image and my talk. I think because some Skype transmission problems. So I will try to synchronize better. Let's see if it will work. And also I want to thank Christophe and Antonio for inviting me for this session. And today, so I was trying to think what exactly, you know, I will talk today, and I saw that maybe one thing that would be interesting is to talk how some of the ideas in the thermodynamics can be applied to study animal behavior, in particular the type of animal behavior that I'm interested in, which is the marmoset vocal development. Okay, so. Sorry, everybody can hear, right?
yeah, we can hear.
Some feedback? Okay, sorry. It's really strange because you don't have a feedback, so it's kind of difficult to see. Okay, so... Let's see. Okay, just waiting to change the screen, your side. Okay, so why vocal development? So I think that the main reason is just because for me it's one of the phenomena that we see every day that is really amazing, right? So when a baby is born, usually they only cry, you know, essentially only cry, sometimes love. But soon after, a couple of months after, you see that this baby that only cry will start to produce some other type of sounds, like a fussing, cooing, and so on, and will start to interact with the mother. And then after, let's say, 6 to 1 year, what you see is that this baby that actually essentially only produces some proto sounds will start now to produce a much more mature type of sounds, right? Usually they will start to babble, which is already some sound that you can recognize as some vowel or consonants or so on. And then, of course, the interaction with the parents will become even better. Yeah? And then after a couple of years, you see that essentially the infants will produce a fully developed adult speech. Yeah. So the question is that what's going on so that essentially this kind of transformation can happen? And this is, of course, it's a very difficult problem. Right? And the reason that I think it's difficult is because it's really a system problem, right? In the sense that to understand how this baby that only cry will start to produce vocalization and start to have a conversation with their parents and other humans, you have in principle try to understand how the vocal apparatus, for example, the tongue, the larynx, you know, the mouth, the lung is changing. But also you have to understand how the muscles that control them also is changing. And of course, you know, we have to understand how the brain is changing. And of course, at the same time, also we have to understand how the social interaction changes, right? Of course, the social interaction in the baby is different from the social interaction when the baby become when the animal become larger, right? And we have to understand this change through time. So it's really a difficult problem, because imagine that actually a vocal apparatus change at some point in time, right? You can think that this change that happened in a very early period will have a big consequence in the future afterwards, yeah? And what's really complicated is because all these different parts are actually interacting through time. So the question is how we can try to understand what's going on, right? And I think that that's why I wanted to discuss this, because I think the one way to think is actually use some concepts from the thermodynamics, right? Some ideas from the thermodynamics. And I want to try to convince you that actually we can do something similar. Okay, so the model system that I'm studying is marmosets. And why marmosets specifically? So marmosets are non-human. So sorry, I forgot about the leg. So the marmosets are non-human primates. Yeah? So actually they are originally from Brazil. Yeah? And they are now very popular. And the reason that they are very popular, there are several. So the first thing is that as non-human primates, they are more similar to human. Yeah, their brain is more similar to human. Their body structure is more similar to human. So several things is more similar to human. The other thing is that they are very social, in the sense that they interact a lot between them. Yeah? And they, and more important, they interact using their vocalization. So it's really something that is not so common among non-human primates to use vocalization essentially all the time. Right? So if you see a macaque, yeah, an old world monkey, yeah, they don't interact all the time with every single one. Of course, sometimes they use, but it's not that they use every single time. In marmoset's case, it's every single time. Okay? The other thing that also is interesting with them is that because they're small, essentially their development happened relatively fast. So essentially in 1 year, you can see the full development of marmosets from the infancy to the adulthood, essentially. So that's also another advantage of marmosets. Okay, so what we know about marmoset vocalization? Okay, we know at least three things that I want to emphasize to you here. So the first thing that we know is that the marmoset vocalization changes through time. Okay, so can you see the arrow?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So here in the left you see what I label cry. Okay, and also subharmonic feed. Okay, this is a power spectrogram. Okay, so in the x-axis you have time, and in the y-axis you have frequency, right? And the color indicates the power. Yeah, and what you see is that the cry is a very broadband type of call. Essentially, it sounds almost like a noise. Essentially, like an infant's cry, right? And then you have this subharmonic feed that also kind of sounds like a cry. Yeah, and after 2 months, essentially, what we know is that this type of call in marmosets, they become this, what I'm calling adult-like phi. Yeah, so the phi is a more mature type of call, which is a very high-pitched type of sound. You can imagine that it is a very high-pitched whistle. Okay. I cannot play the sound because for some reason the sound is not playing to you guys. Okay. Okay. Another thing that what we know is that this transition happened very fast. And how we can show this, essentially what we can do is to calculate this thing that I'm calling phi cry ratio, which is just the difference or the number of phi produced by the infant minus the number of cry produced by the infant at that day divided by the sum of them, right? Of course, if it's negative, it means that there are more cries. And if it's positive, it means that there are more phis, right? And what you see, this is a one example, just to illustrate. In the very beginning, it's negative, which means there are more cries, yeah? And suddenly, around, let's say, day 10, there is a very fast transition so that the infant will start to produce mostly phi. Okay, so it's there is this rapid transition between the mostly cry to the mostly phi. So this is the second point. And finally, the third point, I should actually emphasize it. So here, there is one thing that I'm emphasizing here that I'm called a zero crossing day, which is the day when the phi and the number of cry is the same, right? This is just to mark, you know, when the transition is happening, okay? So when we take this transition, okay, transition day, which I'm calling zero crossing day, okay, and correlate with the amount of parental feedback, which means that what's the probability that the parents will respond back to the infant, right? What we see is that there is a very strong correlation between them. You can see that?
Yeah.
Okay. So, which means that the more the parents vocalize to the infant, yeah, faster will be the transition, okay? So this is another thing that is important. Yeah, and this was a kind of a relevant finding because mostly people thought that essentially a non-human primate wouldn't learn or wouldn't actually change the vocal development because of the social interaction, okay? So this is pretty much the first demonstration that this actually happened. Okay, so there is these three points that we know. Okay, so just to emphasize, Okay. So we see a drastic change in acoustics. This change in acoustics reflects the transition from immature to mature calls, and the rates of transition from immature to mature calls depends on the amount of parental feedback. Okay, these are the three. Okay, so now we want to model this. Okay, so this is the modeling part that I want to discuss and how we can use actually thermodynamic idea to try to understand what's going on. Okay, so the first thing that we need to model is to remember that to produce a vocalization, yeah, we need effectors, right? So essentially, it's something that's it's kind of obvious, but sometimes we don't emphasize is that the brain alone doesn't produce the behavior, right? So here we need larynx, yeah, we need at least the lung and at least the mouth here, okay? So I think that you can see here. Yeah, and the way that we can try to simplify this is to say, okay, lung is something that produces a positive air pressure that will go through the larynx, which is just an oscillating membrane here. Yeah, you can see here. Yeah, and this and the sound that is produced by the vibration of the larynx now will be filtered by the upper vocal tract. Yeah. And of course, essentially the upper vocal tract, which is the mouth, will work as a resonance cavity for the sound, okay? And of course, the property of the resonance cavity depends on the shape of the mouth, yeah? So we can try to model this using essentially, you know, what we know about biophysics and biomechanics. And then we can, after doing a lot of simplification, calculate the normal form and so on, we can get actually these two sets of equation here, okay? I won't go through the detail, I don't have time here, but it's actually it's a pretty simple, well, more or less simple type of equation here, okay? So now some of the properties of this equation, this model is the following. First, it can nicely produce the sounds that are very similar to the sounds produced by real marmosets, okay? So, okay, the figure is still not there. So I just waiting for the Okay, changing. So, okay, here on top, okay, what you see is the spectrogram for the real marmosets. Okay, so the first one, if you remember, is the cry. The second one in the middle, okay, is the subharmonic. And the third one here is the phi, adult-like phi. Okay, so this is the real marmoset, the top one. And the bottom figure is the one produced by the model. Yeah, so you see the first one is cry, the second one is subharmonic, and the other is phi. And you see it's pretty nicely modeled. Okay, and here I didn't even try to model all the details, but you can see that, you know, they're very, very close, actually. Okay, it's fine, everything, aren't you?
Yeah,
so far. The other thing, so there are two relevant parameters for this model. Yeah, and you can imagine that actually the air pressure is relevant, and also the amount of vocal fold tension is also relevant. Okay, if the vocal fold tension, which is the laryngeal tension, okay, is very small and the air pressure is very small, as you would expect, there is no vocalization, right? There is no sound produced. But if it's a little bit stronger, you see that there are cry. And if it's a little bit even more, you will produce the harmonic. And when the vocal fold tension and the air pressure is strong enough, what you see is that this model will produce a phi. And this is also consistent from what we know about the marmoset vocalization. So this model is quite nice. The other properties of this model is that if the air pressure increases and the vocal fold tension increases, essentially the frequency, yeah, or the pitch of the sound that is produced also increase.
Yeah. Daniel, I'm not sure we are seeing.
Sorry. Yeah, I just actually there is a lag. Sorry. I'll just forget. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Just a second. Yeah, there is a lag here. Yes, for some reason. So I'm changing here, but I see that it's not see. Huh? Then what's about? Let me just try to share again.
I can try to show it directly. I have a copy of your talk, so I could.
It works also. Let's see. I will do. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe that's the way. Okay.
Yep. Claudia suggests that you switch off the video.
Okay, now it's kind of so broken. Okay, just give me a second. So I will switch off the video. Okay, and I will switch on. Okay, and there stop share screen, sorry. Mm-hmm. Share screen again, just a second. Yeah, maybe it's just easier if you can use the PDF version. Yeah. Oh, okay, it's okay. Okay. Let's see if it's okay. You can hear?
We can hear and we can see, but it's not that great at that stage. Give me a minute. I will see with the guys if we can project what and the copy I have of your talk. and then you just need to you just tell me to put, show the next slide in like in the good old times, and
that's right.
The network is
but can you project that?
Yes.
Ele
não tem como mandar a apresentação?
Eu tenho por e-mail. Lá eu consigo entrar no e-mail?
Sim.
Põe lá, gente.
You have a copy of it?
Okay, so probably I will continue here now, for now. Yeah, a little bit different.
Sorry about that.
No, I'm sorry that it's not good. So, not at least the, in the correct screen, so maybe I can explain a little bit now, or should I wait?
Yeah, wait a second, we shouldn't be that long.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And we are on time, so there's no hurry.
Okay. Yeah, that's why. Mm-hmm.
Daniel, você cancela o compartilhamento de tela, porque aí vai projetar o que está no computador aqui. E aí eu vou passando para você.
Tá bom. Yeah.
Pronto, agora sim.
So we are seeing the right slide now.
Yeah. So but I cannot see you guys now. What's your showing?
So we are seeing the slide with the title "Effect of Changing the Air Pressure and Vocal Fold Tension."
Maybe just a second. I just want to see, Magda. Can you share your screen with me so that I can see?
Can you show me what can he see what? O Daniel, você não está vendo a câmera, mas exatamente o que a gente está vendo aqui, eu estou mandando para você de volta no Skype.
Estranho, que eu não estou vendo nada.
Nada?
Ah, não, eu tô vendo. Entendi. Tá
entendeu?
Bom,
a gente tá. A mesma tela que eu tô mostrando no projetor aqui, eu tô voltando pra você.
Tá bom, então. Combinado.
Tá bom?
Tá bom.
Legal.
Obrigado. Uhum. Ok. Ok. Let's continue. Ok. Can I? Uhum.
Yeah.
Ok. So, sorry for this delay. So, okay, just to keep in mind, so we have a biomechanical model, and now I'm discussing some of the properties of the biomechanical model, okay? So one thing that is interesting is that, as I showed before, is that the biomechanical model can essentially reproduce all the main calls by marmosets, okay? And another property is that, as you would expect, if the air pressure and the vocal tension increase, you increase the frequency. Yeah, which is the pitch, the F0 of the sound, the pitch of the sound, okay? Another thing that's also it's interesting is to understand what's the effects of the resonance cavity, right? As I said, the shape of the resonance cavity is what determines the resonance property. In this case, the main property that's it's relevant for us is the length of the mouth or length of the resonance cavity, right? And because the marmoset is a very small animal, and the marmoset baby is even smaller, what's happening is that the resonance frequency is very, very high. And actually, in the marmoset infant case, it's around 9 to 10 kilohertz. Okay, And that's exactly what you can see here. So what I'm calling gain here, okay, it's simply the ratio between the amplitude of the sound that comes out from the mouth and divided by the amplitude of the sound that comes out from the larynx before the mouth, okay? So it's essentially what's the effect of the mouth that we are measuring here, okay? And what we see is that when the air pressure and the vocal fold tension is high enough, which will make the frequency high also, the resonance, the gain will be high, essentially, okay? But when, so that's pretty much obvious. But what's also it's interesting is that even when the air pressure is a little bit smaller, like 0.4, and let's say that the vocal fold is around zero or something like this. So even when it's smaller, you see also some bands where essentially there are high gain too. Yeah. So essentially that's because it's because of the subharmonics of the resonance frequency. So there is several, and that will be relevant for us later. Next, please.
Yeah, we have it.
So now the question that we ask is, okay, now that we have the biomechanics, can we actually figure out what is the probability that the marmoset will produce each type of call? Okay, so that's the question. Yeah. And here is the idea that's actually we borrowed from thermodynamics, right? Essentially, the idea is that actually we try to actually figure out what is the cost of producing each type of call, okay? So next. So let's say that the cost of producing cry, okay, it's low, okay? And the cost of producing subharmonic and the phi is actually high, okay? What we expect is that the probability will be the inverse. Next, please. Yeah, so what we expect is that if the cost of cry is low, then the probability will be high to produce cry, and it will be the opposite for the opposite. This is more or less reasonable?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So now we will try to formalize this, okay? Next, please. So how we can measure, can we measure actually the cost, okay? And that, for this, we will use what we know about the marmoset's behavior, okay? And what we know is that the cry, subharmonic, and phi are calls that the infants produce when they are briefly separated from the parents, right? This is exactly like a human, right? When the baby are separated from the parents, yeah, sometimes they start to cry, right? And the reason that they cry, well, the reason why the effect of crying is that it will make the parents, yeah, to come near the infant so that it will take care of the infant, right? That's the same for subharmonic and for fear, also for the marmoset, essentially, okay? And if that's the case, you can expect that the best, it's the most beneficial behavior is actually they will produce actually the highest and the loudest call possible with the minimal efforts possible, right? That makes sense, right? So that is will be the best efforts for the infant marmoset to produce those type of calls, okay? Mm-hmm. So next, please. So if that's the case, now we go back to the gain. Well, actually here I'm plotting the inverse of the gain, okay, just to already make similar to the potential or the cost function that we use in thermodynamics. Okay, so here, just to see, so in the x-axis you see the air pressure, and the other axis you see the muscle tension, and here you see the resonance ratio, okay? And what you see here is that if the resonance ratio is very low, right, which is when the gain was high, if you remember that, and the gain was highest when it was in the high frequency range, you know, when air pressure and the muscle tension were high, yeah, and we know that that is related to the when it's produced the C, okay, we see that the cost is the lowest. Yeah. Can you see here?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the cost is second lowest actually for the subharmonic action. Yeah. And the cost is highest for the prime. Okay. Now, just to simplify our discussion, you just take one section of this landscape here. Okay, next, please. Okay, and this is the one section of the landscape. And I put in, so theta, the parameter that represents the air pressure and the vocal tension. Yeah, you can assume that both are the same here, for example. Okay, it's just one line, the diagonal line in the previous figure. Okay. Yep. And what you see here in color, in green, is the C region, in yellow is the subharmonic region, and in blue is the cry region, okay? So this is essentially what I'm calling now cost, yeah? And the cost in the, is what we, in time you would usually call the potential, yeah, okay? And now given the cost, what's really nice is that we have actually a recipe, okay, from thermodynamics to calculate the probability. Next, please. And that recipe is to use the maximal entropy principle. Maximal entropy principle, yeah? Essentially. And what is the principle essentially just means that given the cost, the probability will be essentially, will have the following shape, right? The probability of observing theta will be exponential of minus some constant that you usually call it the inverse temperature, yeah, times the cost divided by some normalizing value. So essentially given the cost, now we can calculate the probability, right? And the eta here, which is the constant here, we can calculate from the data set. And here in the figure, is the probability density. So you can see that because the cost for the C was the lowest, you see that the probability is highest, right? Fine, that makes sense.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. And then for the subharmonic and for the crime, yeah, it follows also the cost function. Now this is very nice because now we can calculate, we can associate a probability to produce each type of call. Right? We just need to integrate in the region of each parameter to calculate what's the probability of each type of call. And using this we can calculate, for example, the probability of producing phi compared to the probability of producing cry, right? So, and this is what we use to calculate the phi-cry ratio. Next, please. Yeah. And we can, so here in purple is the phi-cry ratio for the data set. Yeah, hopefully everyone remembers to what was the phi-cry ratio. When it was negative, it means that there are more cries. When it's positive, it means that there are more phis. Right, and you see that in the data set you see this sharp transition. Okay, but now when we check to the model, what we see is that actually the model cannot capture this transition, right? So the model is this in gray. I don't know if everyone can see.
Yeah,
so this gray line is the fixed ratio that I use using the model, and the reason it's pretty much simple is because using that cost function, right? The phi was always the most likely vocalization to produce. So essentially, there is no way that it will produce more cry. So the question is, it means that the cost function is not correct. Right? And the reason is actually pretty obvious, because for infant marmoset, for them to produce a high air pressure and a high vocal tension, is more difficult than producing lower high vocal full tension and lower air pressure. And we didn't include that. So now our next task is to include this in the cost function. Next, please. Yeah, next. Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. So as I said, now, what is more reasonable to assume is that for the remember that the theta is the air pressure and the vocal fold tension. Yeah, if the theta is higher, you can imagine for the infant, it's more difficult to produce those theta, right? Because it makes sense that for the infant, actually, the muscle strength, yeah, and the control is weaker. So essentially, it's more difficult for them to produce higher air pressure and higher vocal tension. Yeah, and this is also consistent from what we know from the muscle physiology in human infants. Okay. So when here lambda is just the angle, is the coefficient of the linear line that I'm using to model the cost of the muscle effort. Yeah. And you see that when the lambda is zero, is exactly the situation that we had until now, okay? Essentially, there is no difference in the cost between producing a very high air pressure and very high laryngeal tension and the lower one. But if the lambda is larger, it means that there is a much higher cost to produce higher air pressure, higher vocal cord tension, okay? Next, please. So now, what we see is that it's much more reasonable to assume that the cost is actually the sum, the total cost is the sum of both costs. Okay, so the previous cost that is depends on the efficiency in the resonance frequency of the vocal cavity, plus how much effort actually the infant has to put to produce this type of call. It looks fine. It looks reasonable.
Yeah, yeah. You have 5 minutes. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So now that we have the sum, we can calculate what we can again apply the maximal entropy principle and calculate what is the probability. And then, next, please. Yeah, so this is will be the new cost. You see that when the lambda increases, essentially you rotate the cost function. And now, imagine for the lambda is 1.6 here, yeah, on top. You see that the cost function to produce now, the cost to produce phi now is much higher because of the muscle effort that you need to produce. Okay, now using this, and imagine that through development, what is happening is that the lambda is changing. Okay, next please. Yeah, so this in white is exactly the phi cry ratio that we obtain using the model. And what we see is that the lambda is decreasing. This is what is fitted in the data set. So now we can actually reproduce the phi cry ratio, the transition that we see in the real data set using our model. But there's one thing that still we cannot capture with this model is the effect of the parental feedback, right? Because I didn't include anything about the parental feedback. Next. Yeah. And because we didn't include anything about the parental feedback, this model predicted that there is no correlation between the parental feedback and zero crossing there. This is pretty much obvious, right? And this is not true because from the data set, we know that there is correlation. So we have to include now. Next. And the way to include, yeah, probably everyone already imagined, is pretty easy, right? So given that we assume that the lambda decreases, the decrease in lambda through development is what makes the curve to shift, yeah, to transition from the cry to the phi. The way to include actually the effect of the parental feedback is to make the inclination of lambda through development to depend on the amount of parental feedback. Okay, so here, for example, when the F is zero, yeah, F is the amount of parental feedback. Yeah, you see that the inclination is very small. But when the amount of parental feedback, for example, is 50%, 0.5, for example, the inclination is much faster. Yeah. And when you calculate the corresponding phi cry ratio, you see exactly what you expect, right? So when the amount of parental feedback is larger, you see that essentially this curve, the transition happened earlier than when actually the amount of parental feedback is very low, is zero. Okay, next.
Yeah.
Okay, now using this cost function, what do we have? Do you remember there was a correlation between the zero crossing and the probability of contingent response or the probability of parental feedback? And you see that now this model can model very nicely actually the relationship between the parent and the how fast the infant transition from the immature to mature course. Okay, and next, please. And next. Okay, and now what we have, now finally, if we take all the cost function and we put through time, this is the figure that we will have, right? So here you see the postnatal day, okay, which is the time, theta, which is the parameter, and the cost, yeah, in the z-axis. And you see that essentially what's going on in this, in the beginning, when the postnatal day is near zero, you see that essentially the cost function, yeah, it's deeper for cry than compared to the phi. But when the time passes, essentially the cost function kind of rotates, and you see that essentially the cost for to produce phi is much deeper than the cost for the cry, right? So for the so this is actually, I think it's a nice way to represent the transition between the cry to the phi in marmoset using the ideal thermodynamics. Essentially, what the idea here is that there are these several wells, yeah? And through time, what is happening is that this potential is changing as a consequence of changing the vocal apparatus, the muscle strength, and the brain, right? That is the learning part that happens through social interaction. Okay, so next, please. So just to conclude here, that's I just wanted to illustrate how actually this idea of landscape or the cost function, or if you prefer potential, actually allow us to essentially dissect the role of each element of the vocal system. Okay, and I think it's a really nice way to for us to visualize how these all these different parts actually can come together to produce the behavior, which is for at least for me is the macroscopic observable here. Okay, and next, just to thank, yeah, so I, and then I will conclude just thanking my collaborators here, Yayoi, Phil, and Asif. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, Daniel, and sorry for these technical problems. We have time for a few questions.
Hi, Daniel. It's Antonio Roque here. Hi. Hope you you can see me.
Yeah, I can see.
I mean, the question is, I mean, your model is it is pretty clear. I think the question that one can pose from the point of view of neuroscience is, how can you couple your model to the brain?
So I think that's actually it's a good question. So so here actually the it's of course this is still it's a work in progress. But what I wanted to show is that this is more than actually it's a model, it's more a framework, right? And what I wanted to say is that now, if you have, for example, a good model for, let's say, neuroplasticity, okay, you can actually change the shape or the cost function using the model. I see. Yeah? So, for example, here, of course, you know, I assume something that is pretty much unrealistic, which is that, for example, the cost of muscle is linear.
Yeah.
Okay? And of course, that is just, for me, actually, it's just to show that there is some monotonic increase, which should be reasonable. But of course, the shape probably is not linear. But if you have, for example, a biophysical model, right, you can actually improve the shape and actually just plug in to this model. And now this will change slightly the shape of the landscape. Yeah. And that will be the same for the brain part. You know? So if you have a good model of brain plasticity, you could be able to include actually in this cost function, yeah, and try to model what's going on. So essentially, what I wanted to say that sometimes the at least in my mind is that this framework make clear what's the final macroscopic observable that we want. For me, it's the vocal development. So the brain, the role of modeling for the what's going in the brain will be just one part of the cost function for me. But if you have a better model, you can always improve and make it better. Right? So that will be the idea. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I think we should move to the next talk, because due to these technical problems, we lost a little bit of time. So thanks a lot, Daniel.
Thank you.
So now we have Sergio Neuenschwander.
So good morning. I would think I have 20 minutes, correct? That's right. I would like to make a kind of unusual presentation, because I thought that perhaps what would be the best or more fruitful would be to direct some questions that potentially could work together as a NeuroMat project, or, so to say, horizontal collaborations, then exactly showing my results. But of course, I'll show some. And this has to do with neuronal rhythms. So we'll make a short introduction of the importance of the concept of rhythms, especially neuronal oscillations, particularly gamma oscillations. Hockey made a very important point that to study the brain in general is very important to consider internal relationships that appear in the system. It's very important to consider context in many different aspects. Attention is one, learning is another, memory is another. Interestingly, a lot from what we understand about sensory systems come from a different view, where somehow the brain is put apart from the environment, and you have this simple but very powerful concept that you present a stimulus and you measure response. So the first experiments and measurements of neuronal activity has been always linked to this powerful concept. So rate here means the amplitude of a response in spikes per second. And this has been always taken as a reflection. And this is the very powerful Cartesian idea as a representation, as a reflex, in the sense of reflecting some parameter of the stimulus. Another concept that is more recent is to try to understand how interactions occur in the brain. So it's a different concept in a sense, although you can have this also linked to a stimulus. And I will explain more in detail. So here are some stars of these. And the I have taken some randomly. And Ruth Kugel, she was a very important scientist in the first seminal studies in the retina and the lateral geniculate, so in visual system. And he contributed with a very important concept that in the retina you have different filters. So the receptive field properties are important to understand. Receptive field properties are, this is important because you could understand the way the cell responses represent basic features. And this concept was then developed sharply, very with the obviously the work of Hubin Wiesel and what's the name of your student that was talking about orientation? Renan, and then Renan mentioned this, correct, Renan? The importance of having this idea of filters that you can represent features. Horace Ballo, probably some of you have heard about him. He's very important in developing the concept that the responses could represent very complex features, like, for instance, faces or objects. And Bill Nielsen, a more recent work, very important because he has shown that when you apply microstimulation, you can bias perception by changing the firing rate of the neurons. Well, a very powerful concept and a very, so to say, successful paradigm in neuroscience, that if you understand the cell properties, you understand a lot about how the nervous system represent the stimulus, features, but also complex objects like faces and emotions, memories, and all these things. The other concept, no, it's more recent, this is true, becoming more successful, and puts a lot of attention on interactions in the system, inside the system. So it's important to understand, and comes then the framework of oscillation in the olfactory bulb, the seminal work of Walter Freeman. I think that this is very important, because he lay out a completely different idea of how of the operation of the system, and insisting so pay it a lot of attention on multiple electrode recordings. So in terms of the experimental paradigm, it's very different. In one, you would like to have very isolated neurons and study the property of the response properties of these neurons. And the other, it would be important to record many cells at the same time, so comes then the technology of recording from multiple electrodes, like 64 Walter Freeman, and we are doing hundreds, and now we wanted to have it in thousands. So mentioning the work of Wolfzinger in the visual system, Busaki in the hippocampus, and the Pascal Free attention in the visual system. Just some names, dropping some names, but the idea that you have an extremely solid, successful paradigm and a new one that pays attention on interactions in the nervous system. So all this to say, yes, Hawk, you're right. Studying the network is important to consider the context, so internal interactions, and from his your work, Renan, we could then start thinking on how these network represent features. In the idea of neuronal interactions, the gamma of the projector is very bad. Yeah. There is the gamma. It's a different gamma. It's not that the slide is bad, the projector is bad. We can see much better there. Now it needs to correct the gamma. So, but it doesn't matter. So here an example of a trace in a local field potential of a monkey, you see that eventually you can have very strong oscillatory patterning of the response. And why this became important? First, because it's very easy to observe. And most importantly is the concept that if you wanted to understand the interactions inside the brain, a periodic patterning is wonderful, because you could then establish timing relationships. So this is the basic idea. It's not still a mechanistically idea, it's totally conceptual, and came mainly from the, the conjecture made by von der Marsburg, that when you are talking, you can synchronize in phase. I think that this is a very powerful engineering concept, that you can use phase relationships to transmit information. So powerful concept, and is also true that it's easily observable in the experiments, recordings from the olfactory bulb, from the visual cortex, from the optic lobe of a fly. And also importantly, as Hawke has shown, you can obtain this easily simulating the brain. This is, I think, also important. It's not that it's so difficult to have oscillations. Now, because Doesn't matter. So the essential idea is that you can then establish phase relationships. And here, important discovery, spiking activity can be phase locked to the population. And then again, have population data is very important. The local field potential is like just the local field potential is a local signal that reflects the population. It's like a local EEG. And the multi-unit activity is spiking activity of a few neurons nearby the electrode. And you see that you have very precise relationships of the two signals, revealing that these two signals reflect the local synchronization. That is in fact carried by this fast oscillation at the gamma frequency precisely here. I do not understand why I cannot go to the slides without stopping the presentation, but I do not understand, but doesn't matter. So now I would like to select the slide I would like to talk, because the talks makes the presentation, not the presentation makes the talk, in a sense. But doesn't matter. So here, Francisco Barella, in a very interesting and provocative review made in 2001, I think that 1 year before he died, and he put this idea that the synchrony is what is important, and this could be extremely important for understanding how perception, motion, and thoughts and actions are built in the system. But why synchrony could be important? How this could be important mechanistically? And that there is evidence. I think that it's better that I show less and talk more. There is some evidence. Clear evidence, for instance, in the lateral geniculate to the cortex, that when you have synchronous spikes, also Hockey shown the importance of spike time dependent plasticity. When you have synchronicity, so when spikes happen to occur synchronously, they can produce, they increase the likelihood of a post synaptic spike, so a spike in the target neuron. And if you have now periodic signals, the phase relationship will be then very important for activation eventually of a third cell or network. So this is the idea that has been then put forward more clearly by Pascal Fries, in the sense that coherence or synchronization of signals in the brain could serve for the control of flow of information in the brain. And he used as a point de départ something very difficult to understand, is the how you select objects through attention. And why this? Because he made some experiments in 2001, and he has shown that if the monkey pays attention to a certain object, he produces a strong oscillatory response. Only 5 minutes. And this was very important, because you have here a change of something inside the system that is paying attention, so it's not linked to an external stimulus. You can track a very clear change in the synchronization and oscillatory response, both in the local field potential and the spike local field potential relation. And then he thought, all right, this could explain why you select objects among others, because when you synchronize activity, you open kind of a gate of information, and then you create stimulus or object selection through this. He put forward a simple but very convincing model that is based on the membrane potential. When you have coincident spikes, you have a more or greater likelihood of having the signal being transmitted. I would say a very engineering thinking, but he touched this point of showing that gamma oscillation may be important mechanistically in the way of information flows in the system. Now, I will show from my data perhaps only one slide, that will be a small film, and saying simple things like we have been studying gamma synchronization in the primary visual cortex of the monkey. We have now a lot of, observations that are very clear about the oscillation frequency, about the behavior of gamma oscillation as a function of size of the stimulus, of the characteristics like orientation, like the type of the stimulus, but also during different viewing conditions of the monkey. So the proposal here is that, and of course I have no time for even showing this because I have now only 2 minutes, but the message here would be to have we as a team trying from the simulation to understand or trying to explain our experimental data, and in particular the following one. We used a paradigm where the monkey first fixates for a brief epoch, followed by a blank, and then the monkey can free view a natural scene or a film. And we have done this for natural images and also for gratings. So you collected very, difficult data to obtain that needs now, I would say, an explanation in terms of trying from the point of view of mechanisms to understand the differences that we find for reviewing of natural scene and the artificial stimuli. Here an example. The monkey fixates for a brief moment, a grating. You see a very strong gamma synchronization. When does a saccade, the synchronization disappears. Why this happens? It happens because there is now a different stimulus coming to the receptive field, or it happens because the monkey somehow pay attention to different things. It's because of bottom-up or top-down influence. So these are possibilities that we could test, I would say, very accurately using models. And this could be, I would say, an interesting conversation between experimentalists and theoreticians. And the goal will be then to try to explain some of our experimental data, both in the retina that are not mentioned of the cat during the anesthesia or not, and also in the monkey in these two situations where the monkey fixates natural stimuli and that's also free observation of both artificial and the natural stimuli. So I think that this is a nice opportunity just to acknowledge my people working in the lab. We're a small group then working with the behaving monkey. And I think that eventually we will come with a powerful, interesting criticism that will bridge these two ways of thinking, both based on characterization of single cell responses and also thinking in terms of interactions horizontally in the networks. Thank you.
Okay, so time for a few questions.
I'll try to translate in my vocabulary. In some sense, you're telling that given the past, you, when you estimate a context tree, you don't really estimate the same thing because the probability should already depend on the present state, or on a way the present already anticipates what will happen by this synchronization.
You're mentioning to use the context tree to study attention or to study learning. This is the idea.
Yeah.
I think that will be very interesting. First, you'll be also important to make efforts to understand the contribution of attention, learning, independently. And temporal expectancy. So we could use a paradigm, and we have been discussing of using a paradigm like the goalkeeper in the monkeys in this kind of experiments, and then you can measure if oscillation appears at a different phase of the learning and the different conditions. I think that this is very useful. I would point this as a second interesting possibility of interactions between our experimental team and yours. But my question, what I expect, to see more gamma when you are able to predict correctly. But this is just a guess, based on two findings. One is that the tension increases strongly when you have, as compared to non-attentive. And second, that there is a clear correlation of temporal expectancy and the gamma. And we have shown this in a paper published in Journal of Neuroscience 2012, where we point out this interesting finding. Gamma modulates as a function of temporal expectancy. So it would be nice if we change the timing of the appearance of the stimulus and see if this contributes or not to the modulation of gamma eventually.
Okay, yes. Sergio, two questions. Why gamma is so special? We have the alpha, beta, delta, and also the second question. Is there that relation between gamma and the gap junctions?
The second question we leave. Why gamma is special? Gamma is special for two reasons. The first one is because gamma is fast. And we know that a lot of these perceptual constructions, if we can see these, are performance is very fast. Example, if I present a face here and a non-face here, you need less than 120 milliseconds to point out the face stimulus. So in principle, you do not, visual processing can be extremely fast. Faster rhythm will accommodate better these perceptual dynamics. This is one. But the second is very important because gamma is there. So if you make a paradigm, record the responses, both local field potential and spiking activity, you can see very clear gamma rhythms. So there is also, and it's important to say, the experimentation backs many of these ideas, but not always. And this is the point where the conversation with modelers and experimentalists can be very fruitful. why not other frequencies? This is very relevant. There has been now growing notion that gamma is important for local processing and can be sent in a feed-forward manner. And the beta, that is lower, you'll be more important for building context. And then you'll be interesting to test this using different types of context, for instance, sequences, and to see if this you can have eventually more beta activity linked to this. Interestingly, in our data, we have a lot of beta as compared to the other monkeys. So these are capuchin monkeys, I'm not even mentioned, but different species, and you have different signatures. So maybe this is related to structure, maybe this is related to different visual strategies, although I think that this is less likely. But it's an interesting and, of course, open question. The whole concept is that the different frequency bands is linked or related to different process. This is the point. This is really the case. We need more experiments and more theory, really, to put this forward or not.
Thank you, Sergio. And
I had just a question, but I don't know whether I have time. Yeah. No,
sorry,
this.
Gap junctions may be important for synchronization, for sure, even in the cortex. We do know very little about this. One interesting model, experimental and theoretical, could be the retina, where you have gap junctions linking the amacrine cells and retinal ganglion cells. And I can show data to you afterwards where fast retinal oscillations appears, and these may be linked to gap junctions. All this is important. Anyway, gap junctions are a way of building synchronization, also spiking activity.
It's more like a comment, since he brought the subject to the discussion on context trees, and you mentioned attention, and you also mentioned modeling. I've been saying this towards some people since we started. In my opinion, there are two differences. I mean, the two protocols that we're discussing in the context of the context tree with the sound and with the goalkeeper game, they are different, because in one of them you have a kind of rewarding system, and in the other one you have a more passive one. So from the modeler's point of view, if you consider a model like the one I presented yesterday, which is very simple, doesn't have any mechanism of attention, of rewarding, if you can study the formation of those coherent patterns in that simple model, just a network model with spiking cells, you'd be showing that it's possible for a very simple system to detect, to learn, if you want, some regularities in the patterns. So this would kind of be a bottom-up explanation of the phenomenon that is being measured by Claudia and the guys. But then, and then to explain, I mean, other phenomena like the goalkeeper game and so on, you have to build a larger model, the one which accounts for attention and so on. But at least the basic phenomenon could be explained, because that, but I think, is it possible to have a very simple system without any sophistication like our brain? Just a network system, large number of cells, excitable systems interacting. Would that be enough to explain the measurement of this? Or is it necessary to have, upper structures like our brain has?
The first thing we learned is that it's very easy to obtain oscillation in models, and also it's very observable. So it's not difficult to see an oscillation anywhere in the brain. This is interesting, because this is a fact. The dramatic part of the story is that after 25 or 30 years, we do not know if a gamma oscillation serves for something. This is dramatic in the sense that there is a lot of controversy. 30 years of hard experimentation, hard modeling. And why? Because we do not know if this is important for computation. We do not know if gamma oscillation is really important for visual processing. Example that I have not really time to show, a lot of what has been discovered was using artificial stimulus, a lot of different stimuli. Now, I started then presenting more natural conditions, like reviewing, like the monkey seeing another monkey, so it's not a monitor, and you see that the gamma is, the dynamics is totally different. And then, of course, I can ask, this is important for vision, because I have here the same piece of cortex producing a strong oscillation in a very specific conditions, and when I have a more natural ones, they disappear. So, of course, the experimentation contributes in putting constraints, and but we expect an answer in the sense of, this is important for processing. Why? Do you need a readout of gamma? It's possible to be this readout. This readout will survive the variation we can observe about frequency. So the experimentation can provide a lot of details. The simulation can then challenge the models and the ideas and the theories based on this engineering thinking of phase locking. So this is, in my opinion, this is a completely open question and important, because there is a lot of interest in trying to understand these, the way the networks interact. Attention is part of it.
Yeah, no, yeah.
And should, of course, be included in the ideas.
Okay, so let's have our next speaker. So,
thank you, Pouzat. So I'll be talking now about a work in progress that we've just started, just this project, and in collaboration with Pouzat and Pierre, who's been recently a recent acquisition to NeuroMat. And I'll be talking about the estimating the connectivity graph and spiking neurons as the methods presented by Eva in her first keynote talk, and how we are implementing this and analyzing simulated data, spike trains, and how we are going to apply this to analyze multi-electrode array recordings of spiking neuron data from antennal lobe that of locus that Pouzat has provided us. So the foundation of this work is the Eva's and is the estimator presented by Eva in the keynote lecture, estimated interaction graph of stochastic neural dynamics. And the goal is to apply this estimator. The ultimate goal would be to actually get data and actually have something to say, use the estimator to infer anatomical and functional connectivity of neurons in the network within a neurobiological framework. So I'll be showing basically how I simulated. I have done performed very simple simulations so far, so that we can evaluate the estimator and the parameters involved. And I'll be showing briefly what these parameters mean. And I leave here this lecture will be available in PDF, so you can take a look at the data is already available in Zenodo, and the code will be soon be made available as well. So I'd like to point out at first a few advantages and pros and cons of the method, and at this point of the project, some friendly fire is more than welcome. So at first I'd like to point that they have proved the estimator's consistency and obtained explicit bounds for the probability of getting an actually wrong estimation of connectivity. And it's all beautifully explained, and it's also the last version. And they ensure us they don't need stationarity to get a correct estimation. And as Pouzat has remarked, is an advantage if you compare to other methods such as cross correlograms. Current issues that we're dealing with is that it actually requires a huge amount of data, and it's the amount of data of a number of steps total in the sample, that is little n, is actually grows exponentially with the number of neurons you have at hand. And a feature that I only realized after I implemented the method is that not only it's obvious that very intuitive that it not only depends on the total amount of zeros and ones, but it also depends on the average activity of the neurons. So there's also an issue when you deal with real data that's within with respect to the binning, that because you have to translate this spike train into a series of zeros and ones, and how do you choose the time window? The method has proven to be sensitive to that. So, in order to deal with both these issues, Agabus has proposed us to work with an alternative version of this estimator, which is no leakage, would be in the no leakage Galvez-Loscherbach class of models, that would allow us to work with smaller samples, and I'm going to show you later what it means. So very briefly, to understand what the estimator does, it just takes a series of zeros and ones occurrence of spike or non-spike throughout the series. Works with the basic premises of Galvez-Loscherbach model, that the probability of a neuron to fire is a function of the relevant history of the whole process, of the neurons that I presynaptic'd to each neuron. To the neuron that you want to know the probability of firing the next step. So, and the relevant part of the past goes up to the point that this neuron last fired, because one of the premises that the neuron fires, discharges, and loses memory of what the process did before. So this is what you feed the procedure, and you ultimately will get an estimation of the have an estimation of the connectivity graph of strong enough synapses. Actually, I prepared a little graphical explanation here of what the method does, but I'm going to skip a little bit of this have already mentioned. Just I'm going to mention that the number of one of the important parameters is the cutoff parameter, which is the key parameter that sets a cutoff. So I have to, in order to have a reliable estimation of estimator of the probability of a neuron to fire, I actually have that to consider events that happened often enough in my sample. Also, I defined the sensitivity parameter, which is this discrimination between the probability to fire and the probability of a neuron to fire given a certain pattern, compared to the probability of this of a similar pattern, except that everything is the same except for so if I want to compare with I have a presynaptic candidate neuron K, and I have two patterns W and V, and K is the kth line is different, and they have similar probability as of producing us of observing a spike on the IF neuron afterwards. It means that the K neuron is just basically useless, so it's not a good candidate. So these probabilities have to be different enough. So K epsilon, so they have to be different enough at some points for me to accept J as a presynaptic neuron. So these are the two relevant parameters so far performed as simulations for small networks, as was explained and it's described in the paper that Hawke and Osami and Stofi mentioned. In this dynamic we use a geometric leakage, and I used a linear saturating function in these simulations. So I just an example of a simulation. I'm gonna have show examples of the estimation of connectivity for a simulation that I chose with chosen connectivities like that. So an example here. So this is going to show a little bit what the parameters mean. So here the columns are respect to increasing key, and the row the lines are with respect to increasing epsilon, which is the sensitivity. This is sensitivity. This is cutoff. So red means false positive, blue means false negative, and the light ones mean inconclusive. So if I increase too much the cutoff, I get more and more inconclusive data. And if I'm too soft or too strict on the sensitivity, I get respectively more false positives or false negatives. The other way around, sorry. So this is a summary of the results for simulated data. So for this network, this particular network, I got like, so if I have a large enough sample, a reasonable range of parameters, I've set a reasonable range of parameters here, which would be a starting point when we go to data. And I have similar results obtained with a little bit larger networks with different connectivities. So you've also tested the no leakage model which would be a version of the estimation interaction graph estimation, original interaction graph estimation, except that instead of keeping incrementing counters that store the whole pattern, or just keep the number of times each neuron fired. This, of course, gives me a chance to work with less data. So And the alternative estimator is unfortunately, so it fulfills the expectancy that I do need to work with less data, but unfortunately, it's more prone to produce false positives, so it must mean. I don't understand it quite yet, but I do think that the sensitivity parameter must mean something else in the non-leakage estimator. moreover, the alternative estimator only tolerates the introduction of very small leakage. So I've tested for 5%, and 5% is enough. 10% is it goes off for this kind of network. So this is an example of the locus and tunnel lobe neuron analysis. So I've performed analysis in this kind of data, and this data was is the one that is available on Zenodo, and we've done performed the spike sorting as is described there, following Pouzat's method. And in this particular data, I have 30 minutes of data, one tetrode only so far, and minimum, if I choose a time window of choose the minimum possible time window, which would be the duration of a spike is 3 milliseconds of about 50 points, I get like the n would be half a million time steps, and I have an activity throughout activity of 6 to 22,000 times that each neuron spikes. And this is, so I've said it's sensitive to binning. If I choose a time window from 50, which is would be the minimum possible, and up to 150, which would be three times the window that one spike fit, I get a graph a little bit like that. So up to 100, I get nothing. This is too little data. And from like about 100 to 130, this is a recurrent output with variation sometimes. So this is the most recurrent spot, and sometimes I get one here, sometimes I get one there, and it consistently produces inconclusives in this area. And so this is an issue, the main issue we have at hand. So how to interpret this? So this, you can see this is a very early stage, and I'd like to thank Galvez for the opportunity, and also Pierre Rodahakia helping a lot with analysis and discussions, and he has the challenge now to understand analytically the no leakage estimator version, and I'd like to thank Pouzat that will be working presentially with us next week and help us with the understanding the data and I'd also like to help have the opportunity since we're at the end of the year to thank Rocky and Ozami and Stofi and Miguel and Ariadne, who's not here. And that, I mean, thank you. That it was very important to work with you, and the paper we've published this year was very important to me. Thank you very much.
For coffee, and we can.
Say you probably need data to test. So it's not experimental data as Christoph can provide to you, but that we can run several simulations of the Porchens-Disman module using different neuron models. So Izikevich, ADEX, spiking neurons with you have the voltages and you have this, the RASI plots. 80,000 neurons of this order. So it's a large network. And we can run it for any time you want. So you can have a short or long time to discretize as you want. So you can test it using. So I think this could be a good collaboration between the two teams. Okay.
And did you think it's possible to apply the same idea to analyze the EEG data, considering the aspects of connectivity?
So quick guess, I think no, because it's very extremely different framework, because EEG doesn't have this basic I mean, one of the basic premises is that you can set know how long you can go to the past to predict the probability of the next step. I mean, this is only. You can only expect that. Sometimes, not even for neurons, you can reasonably expect that from if there are regular bursars or whatever, and the slow conductances are important. That's not possible. But I mean for cortical neurons, it's reasonable, but not for all neurons. I mean, certainly not for EEG data. But I mean, I don't know if you. So what would be your?
It seems a very interesting question. As a matter of fact, when I started working with Claudia, one of my first ideas was if it was possible to construct a spatial model with interaction. So in these situations, I make a telephone call to David Billinger, who was the first one. And he said, well, very interesting question, Antonio. The problem is that we don't have a description of the dynamics of an EEG. So here, we could use the description we learn from other colleagues like Bruno Sessac. So actually, when Eva and I start working, we based ourselves in conclusions Bruno made look at the spike train. And we don't have nothing similar to this as far as I know. What people do with EEG data is ridiculous. They make the models using autoregressive models. Well, EEG data does not look like autoregressive models. So we are missing a model. So finally, we did something different using this projection. But this would be a most important question. So I mean, if you look in the literature, people like Olivier Faugeras, people around him, they considered systems of interacting diffusions with an interaction which more or less of the same type. Of course, we don't have this mechanism of context tree description. So it is a real problem. The most important question is one. And another thing is the following. So we have been working with Eva, Rico Pessu, Tiana De Masi, Marcio on hydrodynamic limit of interacting systems of chains with memory variable length. The idea is when you do this limit somehow, you obtain what should be the description maybe of fMRI, in which you make an average or maybe an EEG. But it's not clear how the concrete interaction in the origin goes to the other level. Do you agree with me, Eva? Do you want to make a comment? So I think it's a very interesting question. I wish I knew more in this direction. But you are welcome to suggest things to us.
Let's thank our speaker and have a coffee. Well deserved.
Okay, so 1 year ago, we start to think about the this phenomena, strengthening of the synapses synapses between co-active neurons. It's yesterday we had a good presentation about the plasticity that explained the phenomenon here. Yes, if you have presynaptic and postsynaptic neuron, and if presynaptic neuron fire spike, yes, and after that postsynaptic neuron fire too, it means that they co-active, and the strength tends to be more strength. The connection tends to Yes. It will be reinforced, sure. And in contrary, when the spikes, for example, the postsynaptic spike, and after that the presynaptic spike, it means that they are not co-active, and the strengths will be weaker, at least. Yes. So we have some process that look to the spiking and correct some strengths or correct some force of connection between neurons. Okay. Also, we can discuss a little bit the phenomenon of plasticity in the models of memory attractors, for example. But I prefer just to go to the, directly to the model. Our model will combine with stochastic dynamics of spins, yes, spins fire or not fire, on some finite graph, on some finite structure of spins, with dynamic of a coupling constant. Coupling constant is exactly the connections between spins, and this coupling constant will subject to temporal dynamic. They are changed during a time. So let me explain the model. First of all, I should decide where my spin lives. So we consider a graph. Graph, it's the set of vertices and a set of edges. The graph not change during a time. Yes. So all the graph fix will be finite undirected graph without self loops for simplicity. So for any site here, we associate a spin. Spin? Spine? Spin. So a spin, sigma v, it's some variable, you can imagine, that take two values, minus one and one. If you want, we can interpret one is active spin and or active neuron, and minus one is inactive neuron. So for each edge, so it's it will be some model of our neurons. Okay, so neurons are connected by edges, and for any edge we associate a coupling constant. The coupling constant, at, in some word, it's a strength between we will call it also strength between this between the spins or between the neurons. So what we have, configuration of spins sigma v will have some configuration plus one, for example, minus plus, all these configuration of spins, yes, plus and minus. We should have also a configuration of strengths. Yes, for any edge here, I have a number. And this number will represent a strength. And this number, we suppose, that it will be some number, entire number. It can be positive, or can be negative, zero, but it's entire. One, two, three, four, etc. It means that I just have, I describe you the state of my process. Yes, state of my process is spin configurations and strength configurations. Okay, this pair is strength, is a state of my. So, also will be very fruitful use the some additive function, weight for spin flips, I call it. So it means that for any spin V here, for example, I take the following. The strength times the values of spins. JVV prime times sigma V prime times sigma V. Okay? This function will play, for example, here. What is eta V? Eta V. Eta is some number which we associate with V again. Yes? It will be strength G times sigma V times sigma V, sigma W, sorry. And do you see this W prime or not?
Yes.
It's more or less, it's likely, okay, it's, I should to say that it's W prime, it's W, okay. So the eta V for this particular case, it will be the sum of two things. So, okay. Binary synaptic.
In the previous in the previous slide.
Have
no
states.
Synapses, not
binary
spins. Yes, but it is written there that.
Probably.
In the next, perhaps in the next.
Here.
No, sorry. In the previous, because you said
no.
I
okay,
no.
It's if so. It's probably okay. Some error. Yes,
you
but
said that there is no literature for synapse.
Binary synapse.
Only for binary synapse. You said that there is only literature for binary synapse in the previous literature. Oh, okay. Gillen said that in the mathematical literature, not in the physics literature.
Excuse me, I don't understand the question. It's about pairwise.
Sorry, there is a lot of literature.
Yes.
Where the synapses are real numbers. There is a lot of literature about that.
No. Yes. Here.
Yeah. So what I mean here is that. Mathematically proved with rigorous mathematical proof, they consider synaptic plasticity. As far as I know, reviewing the literature, it's only been considered binary synapses. Exactly. That they can
zero
only
one.
Take two values. Yeah.
Two
that
values,
synapses
yes.
Can only take two values.
Yes.
Synaptic strength.
Yes.
Yeah.
Or a potentiating and I pressed, it's not necessarily zero. Yeah. Yeah, it's only two states, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Out there in the literature, as far as I could check.
So again, spin will have only two. Numbers minus one plus one, and the strength will be any number, positive or negative, entire number. So, integer is integer number. Okay, I defined some, and I should conclude to explain how this configuration change during a time. Okay, this changing will be stochastic process, and what I explain now the transition rates. So for a given state sigma j, yes, for a given state for some configuration of sigma in some configuration of strength, we have two type of transition movements. Yes, spin flip. We can change a spin sigma for minus sigma. Yes, for example, one go to minus one and minus one go to one. With rate, it's a rate is a little bit difficult. Can you see the rate? 1 plus exponent of 2 eta v. Okay, eta v, what I called weight of change in the previous slide. Okay, eta v, this guy. So the people from statistical mechanics probably recognize here the Glauber dynamics for Ising model when J, the interactions, coupling constant are fixed. So, and I want to change also the interaction constant. Okay, the for some given edge VV prime, we have a movement, following movement. We add this product. It means what we add. We add plus one if two spin are co-oriented, if two or two plus or two minus, yes, and we plus minus one, we decrease if they are opposite directed, okay, plus minus or minus plus, okay. So it means that if they they are co-oriented, the strengths increase, and if they are dysregulated, the strengths decrease. Yes, increase, decrease. what rate? Rate it's for this movement, rate always the same. It's constant. In something I expect sometimes when choose randomly some edge, and I want to decide to change the strength for plus one or for minus one, dependent of sigma of configuration. It's clear the transition rate. It means that we have Markov process, and this continuum time Markov process, I call it psi here. No, not psi, xi. Xi here. And also, it is probably for proof, and it's easiest way probably to deal with the discrete time Markov chain when we see not all time, but only the moment when configuration change. So it means that this transition occur with probability C divided by some normalizing constant, and this movement occur with probability N divided by some normalizing constant. In this normalizing constant, it's bounded. It's nu is the parameter of the model. Yes. Nu is the parameter of the model. Yes, and normalized constant it's bounded. It means that it's all results that we prove for discrete time Markov chain. It's hold for continuum time Markov chain. The first theorem is the Markov chain is transient. Transients of some stochastic process or Markov process means that. My process evolving in time go and after that he decided to do not return to some state. Yes, with some state they go return go return, and after that they go and never return. Okay, it means that what does it mean in transients? It's, I try to explain it for our biologists. So a little bit about the proof. It's attention so for mathematicians here, because we use the Lyapunov function criteria for transients. It means that we, if I, the Markov chain is transient if I construct some function, positive, non-negative function f, which satisfies this condition. For example, the increment in the term of mathematics, f of xi should be the super martingale. And every sum, there exists some set A, such where f at A, f at alpha, it's less than infinite of f. It means that if I have some finite state and f of the state infinite, I have, so out of this set, out of this set, we have some state with we have a smaller value of function. Okay, and moreover, this technique gives me some estimation for the heating time. If I start for some state, what time I spend to heating this set A? Yes, and this the Lyapunov function gives me the estimation for this probability directly. So, what Lyapunov function is something about 5 minutes about the proof. We choose the Lyapunov function as 1 divided by eta v, with weights of change of sign. And imagine at the moment that all my eta, all my weight to change a sign, all are greater than some n. They are positive and they are huge, for example, yes. So what does it mean? What does it mean for intensity, for rate for change? If you remember, 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power 2 eta. E to the power 2 eta. It's e to the power huge, and 1 divided by, it's very small. It means that to change a sign for v, it's very small probability. He doesn't want to change a sign. Okay. So this our function is if all of them greater than n, this function, and some constant over vice. So, and this we prove that this function is really Lyapunov function that satisfies two criteria here, L1, L2. It means that our chain is transient. How this transient occur? How we go to infinity? How the process go to infinity, for example? Suppose that tau will be the freezing time. Freezing time I call the time after that all signs, configuration of signs, of sigmas, never change after that time, okay? If it's, my question is, if it's finite or infinite? Infinite means always change, okay? So we proved that it's really finite. How many time? 5 minutes. So it's... No, okay, no, it's difficult to...
We trust.
Okay. We, moreover, we are changing some proof up to now. The third theorem means that all strengths go to an infinity. All strengths go to infinity in by law of large number. Yes, it's. For some positive constant or 1 over e in continuum times. So it's Well, it's the same thing.
Because in the script, I can interpret the easy model as something neuronal. It's continuous, I can't. So I believe it was a continuous. Speaking about rate, it could be the same.
And so continuous type thermodynamics on easy.
Yes, it's holds for discrete time and continuum time too. Yes, it's means that all it's a J, okay? It's not F, it's a J, it's a strength of it's increase linearly.
You are considering the embedded chain.
Yes, embedded chain. Yes, it's skeleton. And the last what I want to show, so imagine it, so we know that after some times all configuration sigma is freezing, it's fixed, never change, okay? And only strengths go linearly to infinity. So what does what type of configuration we can observe? Red it's plus, okay? Minus it's black one, and with edges between them, red it's plus infinity is. So it means that with only this type of configuration we can observe. If we have plus here, it should be plus infinity, go to plus. If they are negative, it should be again plus infinity. Yes, and if they are opposite sign, it means that the weight go to minus infinity. Minus infinity, okay. These configuration are impossible. Plus, and from minus infinity, it's impossible. All this in infinite time. So thank you for attention. This work, it's our joint work with Guillaume and Pichersky. They are here too. So thank you for attention.
So I just wondered, shouldn't the changes in the weights be triggered by, changes in the spins?
Changes? What?
I mean, you say you update your weights.
Yes, up to some time, yes, never change. Yes, if they are freeze, the configuration.
Yeah, but then you continue changing your J, the coupling constant.
Yes,
no?
yes, it continues.
So
yes.
In the more realistic model, shouldn't the changes...
Yeah, more realistic. Think it's probably we should avoid the infinity in this model. Yes, for example, I add something that starting decreasing. Okay, the strengths never increase by one. Plus one, no, it's... plus one, plus half, plus one of it third, something like, yes.
Okay.
So it's our next step of investigation.
But I also wanted to say that you should update the J, the coupling factors, only if you have seen some activity before of the spin flips. I mean...
I don't know.
So in that sense, maybe I don't know the details very much. As far as I know, the synaptic strengths, so somehow they change on a very much slower time scale than the neuronal dynamics, let's say. So you really need a lot of spikes in order to observe significant changes in the in the strength of the synapses. I mean, long-term changes, long-term potentiation. So in this sense, I think that this point in particular, if nu is small enough, I think wouldn't be that far. Taking nu very small. What, for example, it's more unrealistic is that if the two spins are down, which means the two neurons with low activity, the weight is depressed. Yeah, maybe this is not that it happens. Yeah.
I'm very surprised about your results in the sense that the case with discrete values for the synapses in the physicist literature is much more harder than the real synapses that are real numbers. More or less, there is 1,000 of papers about real number synapses and 100 about
discrete time, discrete value synapses. And they proved also that, for example, learning with discrete binary or integer synapses is equivalent to NP complete problems. NP?
NP
non-polynomial
yes.
problems. It's very hard, for example, to learning algorithms for networks with the integer synapses. It's an unsolved problem.
Okay, but here the learning algorithms.
Yes. But the class of problem, it's surprising to me that we can show results for this kind of synapses.
Okay, for this model, I think it's not very surprising. this behavior, yes, it's we intuitively we just. Very in beginning, we just believe that all strengths go to infinity, but the only question was the difficulties to find the proof, how to prove it for any given graph, any something like.
Yeah, and finally, maybe I should make the comment that here we consider that the synaptic strengths take only integer values, but. These proofs are straightforwardly extended to the case in which they take multiple values, so integer multiple values of some fixed real value. So they are still discrete, but not necessarily integer. So
yeah, probably it's interesting model to put on, to associate with edge some Brownian motion, yes, and to see how they depend on, I don't know, external field for this Brownian motion. Yes, how it feel the sigma v prime, yes. Probably it's another model. So, same. Okay.
Go and answer the question. We are late.
I'm not sure I understood very well the result. Like, so if you can explain it again, please. So you said that the Markov chain is transient?
Yes.
But which Markov chain? The two, the coupled and
yes.
the configurations?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And this means that you never return, with positive probability, you never return to the initial state?
Yes.
Okay. And then at the same time, you have fixation. So there is a time after which the process never leaves.
Yes,
a
but fixation
state.
Only for sigma.
Excuse me?
Fixation for only for signs, for sign of sigma, of spin.
Okay, so for specific,
yes,
for
yes.
each specific, you fix.
Yes, yes. They go, the sigma
the
change, and after that, freezing. But the transience means that we have another component, it's strengths, the strengths go to infinity.
Yeah.
Only strengths, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anatoly. So next speaker is Miguel Abadi.
Okay, thank you very much, Antonio, for the invitation. What I will talk about is joint work with Ludmila. It's a work in progress. So probably I will not be able to ask to answer all your questions, but we have some. So the idea what I want to present is a version of a Galvez-Loher-Bach model to describe some the statistical times of activity in the spiking neurons. So it's so I will present the model, the first idea, the first characteristic of the model is some uniform tendency of the potential of the neurons. Then I will describe some the statistic activity of the spiking neurons. So Galvez and Loherbach prove some existence of this model. Then there are some results of Duarte and Ost, which and a similar model. They prove that the lifetime of the system is finite. And well, let me describe. So I will describe specifically the activity times. So let's start describing the model. The model is a Markov chain, finite state Markov chain, and discrete time. So this means that the activity of the next step will depend only on the actual time and not in the further past. So we consider a set, which is a 1 to n, which represents each one of the n neurons of the systems. And then the time is discrete. And with the un I, we denote the potential of the neuron I at time n. So I runs from 1 to n, and n indicates the time. And I runs from 1 to n capital, and small n is the time. So we have two parameters, w, which indicates some synaptic weight, which is always positive, and rho is a leakage parameter. And well, the problem evolved as follows in general terms. The idea is the following: we want to consider the evolution of the potential of each neuron, and how this potential evolves. And the general idea is that one neuron is allowed, only one neuron is allowed to spike at the time, but the system could not spike. When the system...
How many neurons?
How many?
Neurons.
N, capital N. Capital N, finite. And the general idea is that at when the system does not fire at all, there is a leakage effect of rho, which decreases the potential. And if the system spike, I will describe in the following slide. But if the system does not fire, so the new potential is suffers a leakage of proportion rho with respect to the previous one, and that's for all the neurons. And if the system spike, there is only one neuron that spike, and what happens is the following: for the spiking neuron, its potential is reset to zero value. The remaining ones receive some potential from the spiking one, and increase a fixed amount W, but also suffer this leakage effect. So this leakage effect is constant and happens all the time, spiking. Either the system fires or not. But when it fires, it receives also an extra amount, fixed amount W from the spiking one. And the spiking one resets its value to zero. So this is the evolution of the system. And we have to say how the system decides to spike or not. And the system spikes with a probability with this a mean value of a certain function of the potential of the neurons. So we have the phi function is a given function, and which we apply to the potential, and we compute the mean of this function over the whole set of neurons, and this is the probability that the system fires. The probability that one specific neuron fires is just the contribution of this neuron to that one. And of course, the probability that does not fire is the opposite. What is this function? This function is a very simple one. It's in the previous slide. It's the identity if the potential is between 0 and 1, and is and after it reaches potential 1, it's constant 1. And it reflects the fact that the potential, the larger is the potential, the more tendency to spike these neurons has, but add up to some thresholds in which if you still put more potential on this neuron, this does not contribute to the probability to the spiking rate. So the larger is the potential, the larger is the tendency to spike, but up to some threshold, which doesn't matter if after above this threshold, the level of the potential does not affect to this firing. So this function that we choose is that simple one. And the first aspect that characteristic that we show is that there is you can put whatever initial condition you want over the potentials of the spiking, but the evolution of the potential let us consider what is the suppose that the system keeps firing but not the spike the neuron I. What happens to this potential? The evolution of the potential is like successively they took these values. It's updating to this new value, but then you apply new again this function to this new potential, and you can iterate this function, and it tends to become to converge to this quantity, and which will have some importance in this model. So we see that if the system keeps firing and given neuron does not spike, it tends to converge to this potential. And it's happened once the neuron spikes, you see, if you put any U0, this factor will disappear, and the neuron tends to forget its initial condition, and this gives that and it tells that all the neurons tends to become close to this potential, this common potential. So this is what we call this uniform potential tendency. If the system spikes, if the system does spike, you will have to add a factor rho for each instant which does not fire. The system does not spike, and this uniform tendency is still holds. So the first result says that it's more comfortable to order the potentials of the system in an increasing way. So Vn is the ordered potentials of the system at time n. So Vn is just ordering of un. And we prove that if we observe k spikes in the previous time, the potential keeps bounded by these two values. For every t, what is t?
System valid for every t, no. Second line.
For every. For all.
For all t?
No, for all. Okay. For all. For yeah, all. The system spike for all in k. In all the k previous times, yeah. But so this is a minor contribution according to the order, but the actual value is that one. And what happens is what is a consequence of this lemma is that. The probability that the system does not fire depends if you have this tendency, if you have this value for the potential. In that case, under this firing regime, say the potential, the probability that the system does not fire, it depends on the value of gamma. If there is a typo here, it's gamma. It's 1 over n, the probability that does not fire is approximately, not exactly. This is gamma, I'm sorry. If gamma is above 1, there is 1 over n, so it depends, it's very small and depends on the number of neurons. And if the gamma is smaller than 1, then this is independent of the number of the neurons that has the system, and is that 1.
So this is a kind of phase transition.
Yes. Okay. This is.
No, it's the same phase transition of the. I think it's not casual that Ludmila is called. I have the feeling.
This value gamma will depend, will determine different behavior of the system. And I want to show some simulations in dependence on the value of gamma. So gamma is a critical value, but I present here three situations that we are. Pardon?
The time scale is not the same.
It's not the same. It's not the same. I need three sides of the.
What is the time scale there?
The time scale.
1 million.
Not 1 million. I would say what is the time scale? I would tell you precisely what is the time scale. It depended of. Because I will describe now what is the analytic behavior of this spike. Okay. So we simulate one system which is above gamma above one, one system which is above, this is the first one. The second one is below 1, but a very small value above, below 1. And, well, but what the third one, it's also gamma below 1, but with a leakage factor very close to 1. So the other.
Miguel, I guess it's the latest. Miguel.
Eh?
I guess the latest can do something.
Ah, okay. So this also has raw between 0 and 1, but not close to 1. And the behavior is the following. We observe some this flat region. We prove that this is the flat region here is has a exponential or geometric distribution with mean of size n, large capital N, so the which is the number of neurons. However, here, well, here we prove that we are below this gamma, but so the flat region is the spike regime, and then this part is the non-firing. So we observe there is a part which the system keeps firing, then fails or spike in this regime until it becomes to fire again, and it recovers. And then again, reproduce the same fact, fails, and then recovers to fire. Here, it's a case in which once it starts again to fire, it almost recovers its value. But it's not always the case. Here becomes filing and firing, but without recovering to the critical value. And then here fails, and it recovers faster. But then it comes a time when it starts to fail, recovers a little bit, but not again, and then the system dies. And that's the same thing. Here it keeps firing, but and then it oscillates. It starts to fail. There are some spiking in between, but it recovers to the critical value. And here is a very special case in which there is not much difference between the spiking regime and failing with some isolated spikes. We don't see any difference. Rho is close to 1, so the spiking and non-spiking regime is almost the same. It's almost the identity. Observe that if rho is close to 1, then W is close to 0, and the spiking and non-spiking regime is almost the same. So the transformation is almost the identity. So we don't observe any difference. And these three are three real different regimes. So some analytic results. I call SI the spiking regime. Fail, F stands for fail, is that block which corresponds to starting to fail, but with some eventual spiking up to recover to the critical value. And okay, the first result is that the if tau is the lifetime of the spiking regime of the system, so is the tau is the position of the last spike, if there is, it could be infinite. But we prove that the system sees activities. The potential does not reach zero, it's always positive, but it sees activity at some finite time. Then, as I said, the spiking regime has a geometric distribution according, which mean according to the to this critical value. If gamma is larger than one, it depends on the number of the of the neurons. But if it is below, it is this fixed value, which depends of the number of systems. This failure regime has a certain probability to be infinite. So in that means that there is, for instance, here we said that this failure regime is infinity. The size of this regime is infinity, which means that the system never recovers to this critical value. There are some finite regimes, blocks of failures with eventual spikes, but at some point, this this failure regime has size infinity. We don't have the distribution. So B is the number of this kind of blocks that we have here. B is the number of blocks until the last one, which determines the end of the activity of the system. And this is also a geometric distribution. And finally, so the answer that we don't have is the distribution of this F, but we have some interesting fact, which is the following: for gamma equal one, the potential is a martingale, and for gamma larger than one, it's a submartingale, and for gamma less than one, it's a submartingale. I'm cheating a little bit. It's not actually the potential. It's some tilde, some modification of the potential, which means I consider the value without resetting it to zero. Resetting it to zero is an extra ingredient that which is, this is not true, but this value is very close to the UN, because the difference is a contribution of order 1 over n. So, well, this is what recently we found, and okay, we expect to be able to say something more about the distribution of F. Okay, and that's more than 3 minutes.
So we have time for one short question. The time is over.
About this time series.
Yeah.
The previous transparency, that the second time series.
Yeah.
Do you have a similar time series for the case gamma equal to one, the critical case, the critical case?
The, for the critical case,
gamma equal to one. How is the
yeah,
time
series? It's close to that one.
Oh no.
No.
Is it more close to the middle, I suppose. Because the activity of the network, it's almost zero.
But this, okay. If you put...
Ludmila is saying that the second panel,
gamma is near 1?
Both are near to 1.
Okay. But above is the supercritical case.
Yes.
This is probably almost the critical case, and the other subcritical. Mm-hmm. Okay. This process of fall downs and this oscillate, this process, and also yeah. in the first panel corresponds to the avalanche.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. But here the point is, it never recovers to the critical value in that case. But
we are using critical in different sense.
Pardon?
We are using the word critical in different sense.
Excuse me, Ozami.
Yes.
Would I suggest you to postpone the discussion because we are really late. We still have a session before lunchtime. So please, Achilles. So let's thank okay. Miguel, and maybe you can.
So as I was saying, I will try to compromise things that perhaps are not so such an elegant way. And I will try to give an interpretation of an old model in a neuroscientific context. So I would just, I didn't have a lot of, I received a short notice, so I didn't prepare very well slides. So I just think of this as a population of neurons. So the black dots is the population of neurons, okay? Initially, I excite, so this guy spikes, and he attempts independently with probability p to excite each one of his idle neuron neighbors, okay? So these two guys, independently. So this is a dadaistic version of neuron science, but perhaps maybe you can find something interesting about it. I'm not a specialist, so I will not. I will not attempt to persuade you in this regard. So, okay, you can also think of this like the first quadrant, and so with northeast orientation, and perhaps you can think of this as a slice of your cortex, of the brain cortex. Okay. I apologize, but so far I haven't. So these are the neurons, okay? And the arrows correspond to the presynaptic. So whenever there is a possibility, so this guy, so this red guy, has these two neurons as presynaptic neurons, and if they are excited, they will attempt independently with probability p each to excite it. Okay, that's. So that's an old model. It was introduced by Hammersley. It was funded by Hammersley around in the 50s. So okay. So how to define this model? I give you a sequence of IID random variables that are indexed to the bonds of the lattice. So the bonds are the arrows, the edges. Okay, clear. And whenever this guy will come up heads with probability p and tails with probability 1 minus p. And okay, if it's heads, I will put an arrow. If it's tails, I would not. Okay, so what do I have here? I have random graph. And I try to find out what I'm interested in is the well, let's say the shape of a single spiking train in this context. Yeah, it's a little bit fancy, but excuse me. If being pompous, I apologize. So I'm just trying to talk your own language somehow. So I just tried to find out the number of spiking neurons at level n. And I put a 1 whenever, well, my spike train gets there, and a 0 if it doesn't, okay? And so this is what I have here, okay? So for any given realization omega, I have psi n. Psi n is the the set of ones at level n, okay? And I can also do this in a Markovian way, so I can build it up step by step. So if I have two, so here is the number of presynaptic neurons. If the number of presynaptic neurons is two, is just one, the probability that I would get excited is just p. If I have two presynaptic neurons, so both guys, is this thing, okay? You can calculate it. And okay, if I have no presynaptic neuron excited, then the probability is zero. So far, so good. Everyone is clear with the model. Okay, so I can define a probability space that is the product of the probability space that these guys are defined. It's a well understood object. So, oh, maybe I explain a little bit the simulation I've drawn here. Okay, so this is a little bit the rescaled version of that. I choose my, so I will call this, well, the excitability parameter, P, okay? And when I choose P large enough, I will observe an infinite spike train. So my spike train, well, if I'm lucky, okay? There is a positive probability if P is large enough that, well, I will observe something like this. So just because I'm in one dimension, I will have a rightmost excited neuron and a leftmost, okay? And in here, if you would observe the process for a long time, you will get to see a density. Density means that, okay, I very, very intuitively, I just cut a chunk of this, and I just look how many neurons I have in there. Okay? And then in here, I will, well, I'll tell you a little bit later what happens. So, as I told you already, I'm interested in the, so I just sum up ones and zeros. Xi n at x is a zero or a one, depending if the guy at x is excited or not, the neuron, I'm sorry. So I sum up over this random interval, I sum up these random variables. Okay? Now the main difficulty comes from the fact that you have to consider the
interval is between small ln and small rn.
Indeed, yes. The leftmost and the rightmost excited neurons. So I'm interested at the event that I have an infinite spike train. So it might sound a little bit ridiculous, but okay. So anyway, so what I want to do is okay. So I define this event. So this event is the event that there are always spiking neurons in my system. And I just say rho of p to be the probability that I assign to this event. And I will assume that this is positive, okay? So some time ago, Harris saw that, so if I look at this sum, well, what is your guess? How fast will the process grow? I mean, you just look at the cardinality, the number of ones. If you think of this as a branching process, then branching processes grow exponentially fast. So the size grows very large, very fast. But this is not Malthusian law for the simple reason that you cannot have a particle in the branching process interpretation, more than one particle at the same, inhabiting the same space. So you, just because you suppress the extra bursts, the growth becomes linear. So I just sum these guys, I divide with the number of guys, with the number of neurons in my system. So these are both random, okay? And here I have that when I condition on omega infinity with probability one, I will converge to this constant, which incidentally it happens to be the same constant as this one, but I will not go into the details of the proof. So later on, there was a central limit theorem for that. Well, first of all, Harris saw that this is, so in 74, perhaps I should mention out of, propriety, okay, I have to say that Harris in 74 saw that this is strictly positive and less than one. Well, it is obvious that the growth is less than one, actually, but you think about it. So, So the question was open, whereas, okay, this converges to raw or not. So, okay, so perhaps it's best that I draw a diagram here. So I will put here the size of the number of neurons, okay? Sorry, I don't need that. So it's this sum, and I will put here this guy, okay? So I will just put its expected value to have it increasing, okay? So this is the expected value of the interval, okay? And what do I see here? So there is this parameter here, so this is a constant, okay, and when I will observe the size of the process, as time goes by, I will get to see this type of behavior. So this means that if I add an epsilon here, or so if I take any interval, any cone that grows at rho plus epsilon or rho minus epsilon, then my point will eventually be inside any small cone. That's what the law of large numbers tells you. Is this clear? Please, thank you. And then, well, naturally you want to have a more specific behavior about this, and so you would expect that there is also a central limit theorem that tells you that the oscillations around the mean are of order square root of n outside of a probability that is distributed according to a normal distribution. So, eventually, I claimed the result a couple of years ago, and so far so good. Nobody has reported any mistakes. So I now wrote the full version to submit. And okay, I can tell you what is the result. Okay, so I just take the weak limit now. Okay, I also have to condition on omega infinity. That's what this bar means. And then I will look at this sum. I will subtract its expected value. Okay. Sorry, now that we're out of space. But what a fortunate coincidence! It's right there. And then I will have to divide with there is some constant. And then I have to divide with the square root of this, of the random number of summands, which is that, okay? So this is sigma, but you should know that the derivation of 606 has to do with the fact that somebody wrote sigma in a very bad way in the Bible, so it's not the first time this confusion is taking place. And now I know that if I take the weak limit of that as n goes to infinity, I will get, I look at this thing and I say, what is the probability that is in a certain interval? Okay? And then this corresponds to the, so as n goes to infinity, this corresponds to the same probability that the normal random variable, a Gaussian random variable, 0, 1, is in this interval. Okay? So unfortunately, I don't have time to go into the proof, which would take like a bit of more time. Thank you for your patience. And
thank you very much. So, Achilles, I'm very sorry, but we are really late. So I would like to propose you to, if you agree, skipping coffee break and having the last two talks now so
but
that we can have lunch.
First, this is the democratic sort of,
I'm sorry,
resolution.
Could we just go directly to the discussion? Because
no, I mean, it's unethical in my perspective. I mean, okay.
I'm sorry, we are 40 minutes late.
Yeah,
so
but the previous talk had three questions and 10 minutes extra. Law of iterative logarithm. So So you can. So there is some progress made in the law of iterative logarithm and, more refined behavior. So what happens when the law of large numbers tells you what happens when you divide with n? The central limit theorem tells you what happens when you divide with square root of n. So the question is what happens when you divide with n to the power of 1 over p, and p is between 1 and 2. And the strong law of large numbers still holds for the limit in distribution. But you cannot pass to the, you can, the problem is the conditioning. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So let's move to the next speaker, Pierre Audara.
Thank you. So hi, everyone. My name is Pierre Audara, and as Ludmila said, I'm a new acquisition of NeuroMat, and I'm very glad to be here to participate to this nice, I don't know, it's Israel. And so glad to be here as a postdoc in São Paulo. So I will present a joint work with Nathalie Krell and Eva Scherbach, who are my PhD advisor. And so we propose a model for interacting neurons, and we want to estimate the spiking rate. So first I will introduce the model and then give the definition and properties on my estimator. The model is the following. It uses what we call a piecewise deterministic Markov process, for which each coordinate will represent the evolution of the membrane potential of one neuron through time. So here you have an example with five neurons. So you have five trajectories. Here you have time, and here is the membrane potential. And the dynamics here are the following. When there is no spike, you have an attraction towards an equilibrium potential. In this example, it's 1. So if you are lower than 1, you will increase, and if you are upper than 1, you will decrease. And when there is a spike, the neuron that is spiking has its membrane potential reset to 0. Here it's the neuron in blue that has a spike. And the other neurons will receive an increment of their membrane potential of 1 over n, n being the number of neurons. So here, since I have 5 neurons, I have an increment of 0.2. But for a larger network, you have to think to smaller gems, but more often spikes, since there is more neurons. Let's write it this way. N is my number of neurons, and for each time t, for each neuron I, x t y will denote the membrane potential of a neuron I at time t. And what I didn't say is that the probability for a neuron to spike is depends on its membrane potential through a function f that I will estimate. And so we can write the dynamic like this. It's exactly what I said. This term corresponds to the attraction towards an equilibrium potential m, and lambda is the parameter for the speed of this attraction. Here, these terms denotes what happened when the neuron spikes. It has its membrane potential reset to 0. And when another neuron spikes, there is an increment of 1 over n. Okay. So this process is a Markov process. And another way to describe the dynamics is to write the generator like this. So here is the term which corresponds to the determinist evolution between the spikes with an attraction to the equilibrium potential m, with speed depending on lambda. And here is a term for what happens with the spikes. It's plus 1 over n for if this is the neuron that spikes is different. If it's the neuron that has spiked, the membrane potential is reset to 0. So this is the model. And what I want to do is to estimate the function f, the intensity function, and I will assume that this is my data. So I have an observation of the trajectory up to a time t. So t will be the size of my sample. And I want to estimate the function f, and the idea is basically the same as Rock explained. It's to, if I want to estimate f of a, I will count the number of times where the membrane potential is close to a, and that I had a spike, and I will divide this quantity by the total time spent close to a position a. So I will now define my estimator. For this, I need to define the spike times. So t and I are the spike times of a neuron I. And to define my estimator, we need the measures that will allow me to count what I want to count, meaning the jump measure will allow me to count the number of times that I was close to a position A for the membrane potential and that I had a spike. And the occupation time measure will allow me to say how much time I have spent close to a position A. With this tool, I can define my estimator this way, so it's exactly what I said. With the measures, I count what I wanted to count, and I put a highway close to position A with a kernel, and a low weight far away from A. So again, this is exactly what I said. And so this estimator, of course, if I want to know what happened close to a position A, I need to have observation close to this position A. So I will consider events of this type that says that I have enough information close to the position A. And so this is my estimator, and I want to study the properties of this estimator. So I need a criterion to say if this estimator is good or not. And what I will look at is the distance is L2 between my estimator and the true parameter. And I want a criterion that avoids stupid estimators. If you think of the stupid estimator that doesn't look at the data and says, well, I bet that the intensity function is x squared. There's no reason for that, but this is my bet. So this stupid estimator will be very bad for most of functions, but if indeed the intensity function is x squared, it will be good. But I want to a criterion that says that this stupid estimator is indeed stupid, so I will ask the estimator to be good for different functions. Many different functions, and this is why I will assume that the function f belongs to a certain class of function, and I want the estimator to be good for all the function in this class. So this is what we call a Hölder class, and we assume some regularity on the functions. The higher beta is, the more regular are the functions. So this is my main result. So I look at the difference in the distance in L2 between my estimator and the true parameter, conditionally on the event that I have sufficiently many observations. And this is the rate of convergence. So this says that the distance between my estimator and the true parameter goes to zero as the size of my observation goes to infinity. And it goes to zero with this speed for an optimal window h. So I didn't talk about it, but h is a parameter that says whether you look close to a. So if h is small, it means that I'm looking at position very close to a. And this will depend on the size of my sample. If I have many observations, I can afford to be more accurate and look very close to the position A. So this is why it depends on the size of my sample and also on the regularity. So this is the optimal window, and for this optimal window, I have this speed of convergence. And but unfortunately, it depends on the regularity, and if you want to estimate a function, I suppose you don't know its regularity. So I have this result, that say that even if I don't have the optimal window, but a smaller one, I have some kind of a central limit theorem for the error of my estimator. So roughly speaking, this says that my estimator is good enough. And the second result says that my estimator is one of the best, meaning that you cannot find an estimator with a faster speed of convergence in a asymptotic. So maybe we'll find an estimator with the same asymptotic and a better constant, but not a better asymptotic. To conclude, I wanted to show some simulations I made. So I simulate the sample with a given function. Here in red, you have the true parameter, which is the identity function. And in black, you have my estimator. And in blue, you have the distribution of the membrane potential. So you can see that for high value of membrane potential, we don't have many observations. This is natural because first there is an attraction towards the equilibrium potential one. So if you have a high membrane potential, you will decrease. And the higher the membrane potential is, the more likely you are to be reset to zero, spiking. So it's natural that we don't have many observations for high membrane potential. And since we don't have many observations, our estimator is worse. It's clear. So this is for the identity function. And for the logarithmic function, we have the similar behavior. And for the exponential function, also similar behavior. And thank you.
As I gave Achilles the opportunity of one question, maybe I should give to you also. So, any questions?
Very short one. So, yesterday, Hawk discussed a lot how they found a function phi to make the simulations. So, you are considering the same model. So, maybe we could comment how this tool could be used by Hawk.
Well, I don't know exactly if it's the same model, but yeah, it's close. Okay.
So you are not asking what is the interaction, but what was just asking the function. Yeah. So that's the same question. So this is a suggestion. I think you should go to Ribeirão Preto to spend a week
there,
drink wonderful beer, and discuss how to estimate.
Okay, but as far as I understood, the method is quite the same. You count the number of spikes for a given position, and you divide by the. It's the same ID, no? Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Let's thank Pierre Hodaran. The next speaker is Guilherme Via, and it's the last speak of the morning, so afterwards we have lunchtime, and then we have a round table which is supposed to start at 2 p.m. So.
Okay, so, well, first of all, thank you for still being here. The last talk, I guess it's a big responsibility. And thank you especially to Antonio for giving me the opportunity to be here. Okay, so I'm Guilherme Via, and I'm a postdoc researcher here at the group from Antonio. And I'm going to give you here very very preliminary. So this is results I obtained just a couple of weeks ago, very recent. And of course, I won't have the need to introduce the model because I think you are all pretty familiar with it already at this point. So these are computational results on the model that we've been talking about these days, in particular in the mean field limit. So I think this is the first time we work in this limit, at least computationally. Okay, so
the contents of the talk are basically this, so I will just briefly introduce the system quickly. I will just mention very briefly which are the solving methods I consider, and I will present the solution for a simple particular case, the transients and the stationary solution. So, about the system. Actually, it's very appropriate that Pierre just presented now because he introduced basically the model from which this is based, which is the continuous time version of the so-called GL model. Here we have a system of n neurons, again. They are connected all to all, so all pairs of neurons are connected with the same strength, 1 over n, as in the previous case. Moreover, in this case, I'm considering no leakage. Okay, this will be further extensions to the model. But instead, I consider gap junctions, in particular of strength lambda. Again, the same as in the previous model. So the evolution of the system can be pretty well understood. If a neuron fires, its membrane potential is reset back to zero, and it feeds all other neurons from the network with a fixed amount, which is given by 1 over n. Moreover, in the absence of spikes, all membrane potentials diffuse, drift deterministically towards the mean of the population with a fixed rate lambda. So this is the spiking rate function. Here in continuous time is a spiking rate, which means that basically this function times a small delta will give you the probability for a neuron to spike if it has a membrane potential between x and x plus delta. And I'm considering the limit of infinitely many neurons. So I'll consider n going to infinity. So as you can see, this consists on a homogeneous population of neurons. Here all the parameters are homogeneous across the population. And as I will mention, further extensions of the model will consider homogeneous gap junctions, leakages, and synaptic strengths. So what do we have in this limit? In this limit, so it was shown in the paper by Demassi et al. 2015, that the state of the system is described by a single function, which is this function rho sub t of r here, which basically gives the membrane potential distribution across the population. What does that mean? That for any time t, this function times a small delta gives you the fraction of neurons of among the population whose membrane potential is between r and r plus delta. I don't know if it's clear enough. I hope it is. So in this paper, it was shown how, in this limit and for this system, this function fulfills this differential equation, well known from fluid mechanics as the so-called advection equation. Here we have a term that accounts for spiking. So the function decays because neurons spike. So neurons that spike lose memory potential x. They don't have memory potential x anymore. We will see later what happened with them. And here this parameter v plays the role of the velocity in the analogous with the fluid mechanics. And here, in this particular case, it's given by this expression here, which is the big difference with previously considered cases described by equations with this form. So this function v has a linear term on x. This here describes the evolution according to the membrane potential, the gap junction, sorry, the effect of gap junctions. So as I mentioned, this yields deterministic drifts of all membrane potential from all neurons towards the mean of the population, which is given by this variable here, and which occurs with the parameter lambda. This is the main parameter of the model here, that we have no leakage. Moreover, there is this second term here that accounts for the input that all neurons receive because their neighbors are firing. The input to receive from spikes of other neurons. And these two variables are given by these expressions here, which are nothing else but the mean of the membrane potential across the population and the mean of the spiking rate function. Or otherwise, this parameter very important to describe the model, this gives the fraction of neurons in the population that are spiking at time t. Of course, rho sub t of x is a probability density. So we must normalize it. Its integral across all possible values of memory potential must be 1 for all times. And in order to fulfill this condition, we can use the reset potential condition, which is where all neurons that spike go somehow. Let's say all the neurons that are lost here, that do not have memory potential x anymore, now they will have memory potential 0. So this is the reset potential condition. And of course, we have to add the initial distribution. We must consider initial distribution from which the system will start. OK, so well, here I can mention briefly that I use some analytical method for a simplified case, very, very simplified. I didn't have time to consider the full model. And mainly the reason is that because this parameter, this function here, depends on the solution, this makes it very hard to treat analytically. And so far, I couldn't find in the literature any similar case. And also because of this boundary condition, which again depends on the solution. So for this analytical case, very simplified, as I mentioned, and I just use it for a sake of checking of tests of the numerical solution and to gain some intuition on the evolution of the system. For this, I use the method of characteristics. For the numerical solution, which is the one I'm focusing on, I use the so-called Lax-Ventroff method that presents certain advantages for this kind of equations that I'm not going to mention here. OK, so with this, I can just briefly show some results, some preliminary results I obtained. And here, I only had time to consider a very simplified case. So I'm considering this particular shape for the spiking rate function. It's probably the simplest or the second simplest case we can consider besides the deterministic, where the spiking rate function is 0 for all memory potentials below a lower critical value. And it's 1 for all memory potentials above a second upper critical value. And in between, it's simply linear, okay, and imposing the continuity of the function at both boundaries. Moreover, also for simplicity, I started from an initial distribution given by a decaying exponential, probably the simplest case we can consider again. Also because, so one can easily see that we need this amplitude to be equal to the decaying rate in order for the normalization condition to be fulfilled. But also, because we need this initial distribution to fulfill the boundary condition at 0 that I just presented before, what we have is that there is a single value of lambda 0 from this initial distribution for each value of the parameter lambda for which this initial distribution fulfills the boundary condition at 0, provided that it has this shape. Well, if I'm wrong, maybe we can okay, so what happened, actually I tried this numerically, and the problem then was that when the system started to evolve, because the system wanted this condition to be fulfilled, you have a sudden jump in the value at 0, but then you have some numerical issues. The discontinuity of the variable starts to bring some oscillations in. So this is the problem I had. OK, so for this particular case, I could get some results already. And here I show you the results for different values of the parameter lambda, of the strength of the gap junction connections. Basically, lambda here is 0.1, 0.3, 0.5, and 0.7. And the different curves correspond to different times. So I'm showing here the whole evolution of the system. It always starts from this initial exponential decay, the blue curve. And actually, this amplitude at 0, it's different. Lambda 0 is different because, as I mentioned, it depends on lambda in order for the boundary condition at 0 to be fulfilled. So as we see, for larger values of lambda, this lambda 0 must be lower. But then the system monotonically evolves towards what seems, what looks like the stationary distribution. So here I computed, from this starting time, let the system evolve, and waited for quite a long time that to see if it really didn't change. And so far, for the computing times I considered, it didn't. So it really looks like, for this particular case, this would be given by the stationary solution. So here are the black lines for the different corresponding cases, which we can see here for all the different cases. So here I didn't really have much time to analyze these results, but it looks like, so here blue is for smaller lambda, and we go in this direction, increasing lambda. It looks from the solution, from the analytical solution, that in the limit of lambda equal to zero, this should converge to something like a Gaussian. I didn't have time to check it properly, but it looks like, with a peak at x equal to zero, at zero membrane potential, where you would have the maximum, the plateau of the Gaussian. Then by increasing lambda, you see a shift of this peak towards larger membrane potentials. I guess this is because of the gap junctions are stronger. So the strength of the gap junctions makes the membrane potentials to drift quicker, to drift faster towards the mean of the population before they have time to spike, let's say. This more or less looks like reasonable to me. So this peak moves to larger values. We have that the mean membrane potential of the population is larger, and a sharper decay for larger values of lambda. So far, I'm sorry, I cannot say much more. So I think I'm short of time. And yeah, just to briefly show the references they followed, and to mention that, of course, we are thinking about many extensions to the model. We will probably consider a leakage. We will consider inhomogeneous populations with inhomogeneous properties. But this is still ongoing work in progress. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Guillaume. So one short question before finishing the session.
I liked it very much, as Guillaume. I asked this question to Guillaume a few months ago. Obviously, I'm not expert on this. And it was, the motivation was I started discussing with Enrico, Eva, about the behavior of our system when you look at it as a, well, I mean, field limit or something like this. Because if you want to convince biologists that our model is interesting, you should tell them, look, when you observe fMRI data behaves exactly like the model predicts. So we still don't know. I have been asking neurobiologists if they read qualitative descriptions of time evolution of MRI data or EEG data. I never found an answer. Pedro Valdesosa had the apparently said that there was description, but I never found them. So that was an attempt to show to Sergio, to Claudia, the time evolution, say, when you look at the fMRI data, you see this? I don't know. So and Eva discussed it with an expert, a colleague expert on this. And then I suggest it to Gideon, who did everything alone. I'm not able to help him. And Pierre Collet was there, and they discussed for a few hours, not days, a few hours. So I'm very happy. So see, now you are going to Chile. You are going to present this in Chile. You are going to Chile now, to Santiago. You are not going to Chile? Oh, I believe it was. OK, unfortunately. Okay.
Don, we would have a 10-minute discussion now, but it's 25 past.
We should stop.
We have to come back.